Welcome to the webinar for the ACE on research on healthy aging. My name is Jan Hoeijmakers. Before I start, let me say that I have nothing to disclose, and I'm associated not only with the Department of Molecular Genetics of the Erasmus Medical Center, but also in Cologne, a laboratory, and in Utrecht in the Princess Maxima Center, and I'm part of the Oncode Research Institute. So, research on healthy aging has two different but very important components. One is the molecular mechanism of research on the molecular mechanism of aging, and the other is the epidemiological studies, so the population and models. And that will give rise to insight that can be used for prevention and for therapy, and in the end, of course, we hope that it will lead to sustained health. And in that regard, it is in line with the Erasmus Medical Center mission for research that promotes the mission of a healthy population. And the strength of this academic center is that it combines in a multidisciplinary way different disciplines to try together jointly to try to improve health for the population and bridging the gap between basic research and the clinic. Of course, within 20 minutes, I cannot present all of the work that is being done in this ACE, so I would like to highlight only one aspect, and that is work that in which we are ourselves involved, involving molecular mechanisms of aging and the contribution of many different people and institutes. So the work has been done mainly in the Department of Molecular Genetics of the Erasmus Medical Center. And it started with this problem. DNA gets damaged all the time from outside, UV, chemicals in food, in air, in water, but also from within the cell. We have our own metabolism generates reactive oxygen species, ROS, alkylation products, formaldehyde, but even water damages DNA, and that leads every day, we estimate, up to 100,000 damages in every cell of our body. And of course, if DNA is damaged, the metabolism that depends on intact DNA is affected. And there are two very important consequences. One of them is that damaged DNA, when it is used for duplication of the DNA, for cells to replicate, then there is a higher chance that you make a mistake, a mutation, or that chromosomes are broken and get lost, so chromosomal aberrations. And if this happens, there is always a chance that it leads to cancer. So cancer starts in the vast majority of cases with damage in an individual cell that leads to uncontrolled proliferation and in the end, cancer. But another consequence that we have, particularly in Rotterdam, developed and discovered is that DNA damage not only can lead to mutations, but can also block transcription particularly, and also replication. And that leads to transcription stress, replication stress. The cell cycle can, the cell can decide to delay progression. That can lead to a permanent arrest. In the end, cells can senesce. And also transcription can be affected. That leads to transcriptional stress, functional decline, and cells can die. And all of these effects, we think, promote aging. They are the basis of systemic aging that occurs with everybody. Fortunately, we have repair systems that deal with the damage as much as possible, but even when you have a normal repair, then still, there are some lesions that are never detected by any repair. And some lesions are irreparable. The damage is too severe. And sometimes repair is there too late. And also it can be that with repair you make a mistake. So still DNA damage lesions will accumulate and cause cancer and aging as we experience it in normal people. But of course when you are born with a defect, an inborn defect in a DNA repair system, then all of these consequences happen faster. And that is what I would like to show. I take only an example. These are, what I will show, patients that are defective in one repair system that is called transcription-coupled repair. I have no time to explain it. I'll show you the syndromes, the patients. And one of these very rare diseases is called Cockayne syndrome, one in a million. Very, very, very severe disease. five genes involved, these children have no cancer, but instead they have very severe neurological and developmental abnormalities and the life expectancy on average only 12 years. And this is Baptiste, a French patient, 3 years old, now 7 years. You see already, is very small, needs a hearing aid, cannot see well, cannot walk, cannot speak. And Baptiste became only 10. And for comparison, that is his sister, 1 year older. So you see the traumatic disease, and we have no cure for them. But I'll come back to that later. Keep it in mind. So another disease, which is equally, maybe even more severe, is called trichothiodystrophy, TTD. Many features in common with cocaine, but on top of that, these children have something very peculiar. They have brittle hair, brittle nails, scaly skin. How can it be? And in this case, another repair defect is also involved. These children have a defect also in global genome nucleotide excision repair. Another pathway, partly overlapping, and I have no time, unfortunately, to explain, but these children have, on average, maybe a life expectancy of only 5 or 7 years. So very devastating diseases. And multi-organs that are affected in these children, but primarily organs that do not divide so often in the body. The liver, the kidney, the skeleton, not so the hematological system in this case. So it's called segmental aging. It's not the full spectrum of aging. So one of the ways to try and find out what is going on in these very rare children, one in a million, is to try to make a mouse with the same defect in the same repair gene as these children do. And I show you one mouse. In the world, we are the leaders generating mouse models for these pathways. And this is the TTD patient, and this is the mouse. And you see the mouse also has brittle hair, brittle nails, scaly skin. So the mouse has striking parallels with the human disease. And that is very valuable, because now we can study the mouse instead of these rare children, and we can study every organ and tissue at any moment in time. And then there was an eye-opening observation. These mice became gray, and they developed kyphosis, bending of the spinal cord, as you can see, and they became cachectic and overall frail. And actually, at that moment, when we made this discovery, TTD was not known to be a repair disease with aging phenotypes. So the mouse actually showed that TTD is a premature aging syndrome. These children are aging without us realizing it. And we can investigate every organ and tissue, and it's no question that in many organs and tissues there is accelerated aging. But these mice still live about 1 year and a half. A normal mouse can live 2.5 years. So it's segmental, and it is only for post-mitotic tissues, the liver, the kidney, the skeleton, but not so much, for instance, the blood system. So we wondered, so TTD, what originally was thought, is a neurodevelopmental disease. No, we think it is primarily aging that occurs so early that the development is already compromised. So what we wondered now, we have this TTD mouse, we have made many mice with other repair defects. What would happen if we would cross this TTD mouse with an other mouse to make the repair defect more severe? And then there was so we crossed it with an XPA mouse, for instance, but we have other mice too. I'll show you only the XPA mouse. This is the XPA mouse by itself. That is a mouse that has a repair defect, but gets primarily cancer, particularly after sunlight in the skin. Skin cancer. The TTD mouse is the one that shows aging and actually has less cancer. You see already losing hair and is small, becomes 1 year and a half. And now the double mutant, which has more repair deficiencies, lives only 3 to 5 weeks. So if this single mutant ages in 1 year and a half and you make the repair defect more severe, now the mouse lives only 3 to 5 weeks, apparently aging is so much accelerated that the mouse lives only 3 to 5 weeks. Well, this was very controversial at the time when we published this, but it is since unequivocally established. The severity of the repair defect determines the rate, the speed with which accelerated aging occurs in these mouse models. And apparently you can compress aging from normally 2.5 years in only 3 to 5 weeks in the mouse by making these double mutants. So there is a dose-response relationship, and it always points to causality. So there must be the reason, the repair defect must be responsible for this aging. Well, it took the aging community a long time to realize, but now many of the people are in line with our view. And we have not only this mouse, we have made many mice, CSA mice, CSB mice, crossed with XPA, with XPC, whatever, and we still see XPG, the same outcomes. So now I show you another mouse that has 4 repair defects. So not only the 2 that I showed you before, but this is a mouse that has the code ERCC1. Actually, that was also the first human repair gene that was cloned in Rotterdam, in mammals, in humans. And we have made also a mouse for that mouse, for that disease, and later discovered after we made the mouse that there are also human patients that are suffering from this disease. But this mouse has a defect in 4 repair systems, and now shows aging also in the organs that show the vision, that divide, like the bone marrow. So I'll show you this mouse, and this is the champion in the world of widespread aging. Now we think all organs and tissues are accelerated in aging. This mouse has vision loss, so can see when it is born, but then becomes blind in a couple of months. Hearing loss, has neurological abnormalities that are very severe. I'll come back to that in a minute. Hypertension, vascular stiffness, cardiological aging phenotypes, kyphosis, osteoporosis, the kidney, the liver, the skeleton, the muscles, the skin, also incontinent. But this mouse lives 4 to 6 months because we did not make a full knockout. So now this mouse is a beautiful model because it develops initially, and then you see accelerated aging, as far as we say, everywhere. And we think this is the typical multimorbidity that you also see with normal aging in humans, but also in other organisms. So, and this happens when spontaneous DNA damage, you cannot repair it very well, like in this mouse. But remember, even with repair, you will get this in the course of time. And what I would like to highlight, this mouse is showing aging in the brain, very severe. And I'll show you on this slide. So this is a section through the brain of the mouse. This is a normal mouse, 8 weeks old. This is the ERCC1 Delta mouse, the mouse that I showed you before. And the section is stained for a protein that, when the neurons are not doing well, are being synthesized by the astrocytes. That's another cell type in the brain. And you see, the more brown, the more of that protein is being made. And you see there is brown staining everywhere in the brain. And if you look at the neurons, how many neurons are dying at the age of four weeks. In a wild type normal mouse, no neurons are dying, but in the ERCC1 mouse at 4 weeks already, some neurons are dying, and more so when they are 16 weeks. So there is a gradual loss of neurons, and actually what we see is that the brain is shrinking, and these and there are ventricles that become much bigger. And the neuronal plasticity, the manner with which neurons communicate, is affected. And they lose the memory, and they cannot move. I'll show you later. And they lose vision, they lose hearing. And actually, we are now totally convinced that this mouse is the best mouse in the world for dementias in which proteins aggregate, like Alzheimer's and Parkinson and frontotemporal dementia and ALS. All of these diseases where the brain is showing aging because proteins are aggregating, these mice show it because the main risk factor for all of these diseases is aging. And in this mouse, the brain is aging faster than it normally would. Actually so fast that it resembles Alzheimer and Parkinson in many regards. I have no time to explain that to you, but this mouse is the best in the world for these diseases. So, what we also found, and that was another very important observation, when we looked at the activity of all the genes in these mice that show accelerated aging, and we have many mouse models, I showed you only a few, When you study the activity of all the genes in the liver, in the kidney, and in many other organs, we see that the genes that are normally used for growth, they are down. So these animals actually stay small, and these children too. They suppress their growth, and they use their energy not for growing, but they use it for resilience mechanisms, for defense mechanisms, for antioxidant defenses, for stress resistance. So they have a different strategy to use their energy not for growing, but for defense, for making you resilient to many different stresses from outside. And low IGF, insulin growth factor 1, which is needed for growth, low levels of IGF-1 not only occur in the mouse, but also in the patients. And explains why these children with Cochrane syndrome, they all stay very small. So they are constantly suppressing growth and boosting their resilience and defense mechanisms. And that we call a survival response, because it resembles when you have too little food, dietary restriction, then the body is very wise. It doesn't waste the energy for growing. It, at that moment, uses all the energy to try to survive the period that you have no food, the period of starvation. So, and that is known to delay aging. Dietary restriction in yeast, in worms, in flies, in mammals even, and also even in non-human primates, delays aging. So we think this is an attempt of the organism to delay the rapid aging, because it feels it's going too fast. So we call this survival response, and actually, like dietary restriction, tries to delay the accelerated aging. So these repair mice that live only short and that are small because they suppress growth and they boost defenses, get actually normal food. So we wondered what would happen if you would put these small mice, these tiny mice, on a diet. The last thing probably you would like to do with these children too that are small is to put them on a diet. Actually, they get more food because they have to grow. So we wondered, you know, what happens when you will put these mice on calorie restriction. Well, this is a survival curve of the same mouse that I showed you before, the females, but the males are not different, so I show only the females. And when they have unlimited food, the first mouse dies at the age of about 12 weeks, and the last one had died by 27 weeks. So they live about half a year. That's what I also explained. Now, the other half of these females were put on a diet. So when they were 7 weeks old, we reduced gradually food to 30% less than they normally would eat. So they have 30% lower food intake. And then we followed what happened. And then this happened. The mouse lived three times longer from the moment you start on diet. So there is a 200% lifespan extension, which is dramatic for mammals, unprecedented. So counterintuitively, giving these mice less food makes them live longer. So, but we wondered, they are living longer, but what happens with aging? Well, I can tell you, the mouse is an ideal model for studying all the organs and tissues, and wherever we looked, all the accelerated aging was dramatically delayed, and particularly the rapid aging in the neuronal system in the brain. And therefore, I will show you two videos. So these are two littermates born at the same moment. They are both mutants, now 16 weeks old. This mouse over here had food all the time. And you see, it cannot normally walk anymore. It shakes. It has these tremors. The muscles are not anymore well controlled by the neurons. The neurons are declining in function, and these mice, they get tremors and spastic movements, and they cannot even keep balance. But the same mouse on a diet from week 7 onwards, here running around because it thinks I get food, but neurologically in a much better shape, can run, can walk normally, has no problems. If you put these mice on a rotating rod, a rotor-rod experiment, this one on the diet that I showed you before, the one that had the food all the time but then couldn't walk, This one is a normal mouse on a diet, and the fat one is the normal mouse that had unlimited food. I'll start the movie. Already in the first round, this one drops. And now it starts to run faster and faster. After 3 minutes, the fat mouse has dropped, and now the wild-type mouse is dropping from the bar. Well, in this movie, yeah, the wild-type started to drop first, but normally there is no difference between this mouse and that one on diet. And this one is the mutant. So there is a tremendous benefit from simply less food, also for the neuronal system. So calorie restriction would work better than any medication would be expected to work in this mouse model. And if it would apply to cocaine syndrome children, instead of average 12, they might become 36, three times as long. And they would be in a much better condition. But of course, mice are not humans, and particularly these children, they are very fragile. They are tiny, and they get extra food. So it is very putting these children on a calorie restriction diet is very counterintuitive, and it was controversial. And many clinicians and dieticians, said this is criminal. You should never do that. But I'll show you now one first patient. She is a TTD patient, Emma, 7 years old. I cannot show you videos, but I can show you the outcome of what happened when we reduced calorie intake for Emma, a child with this brittle hair disease that I showed you also in the disease that I showed you before. So Emma was at that moment 7 years old, and she normally has 1150 kilocalorie directly in the stomach because these children have very poor appetite. And now we reduce the calorie intake in steps of 100 to 835. And see what happens. You can always go back if things go wrong. But Emma regained appetite. When we reduced her calorie intake, then she started to eat herself. And of the 835, 640 were she takes directly herself, and the rest she still gets extra. So she's not at all starved. And then in 2 weeks, she had already these tremors like the mice. She lost all tremors. So she improved. Not only the decline stopped, no, she even improved very much. She didn't get these tremors. Before, she couldn't put two Duplo blocks on top of each other. Now she could play with Duplo again. And then when she lost weight, the dietitian became nervous, so she had to increase daily intake. And then she regained her tremors. And when she went back to the low intake, the tremors went back, disappeared again. So, and this happened twice. So there is a direct link between the amount of food and the neuronal functioning, particularly in these children. She does miraculously well. She is very active now. She is interested. She participates. She is explorative, eager to learn, and in a good mood. And she enjoys now a stable health for close to 3 years, which for these children is a very long time. And even though she has less food, she grows in length. She lost weight because she became thinner, but she did grow in length, and she now can walk. She never could walk. Now she can walk. She can speak. She couldn't pronounce words. Now she can speak. She can count. She can verbally respond. And she is starting to write her name. So instead of worse, she is much better. So we think that calorie restriction and food nutrition keep a tremendous promise, and not only for these children. So when we presented these data at a recent meeting for cocaine and TTD patients and families and clinicians and scientists, uniformly it was decided, no, these children, instead of extra food, they should get less food. And what I hear now from parents, they are all positive about this. So clinical trials are ongoing. But you can see a lot about Emma on this Facebook page. So calorie restriction keeps a tremendous promise to delay aging. And we think it is also very important for many other very important medical applications. And this is the one of the last slides with data. So we think it the impact exceeds far these very rare premature aging DNA repair syndromes that occur one in a million. No, this concept will also apply to surgery, all surgery. When you have surgery, there is ischemia reperfusion injury afterwards. When for a time there was no oxygen because the surgeon clamped blood supply to the area where he where the surgeon is operating. After the operation, that whole tissue had a lot of has no oxygen for a long time. So whenever oxygen comes in, then you get a lot of oxygen radicals that are formed and that cause damage. And that damage the whole tissue that has been deprived of oxygen for a long time. So we get ischemia reperfusion injury. But very paradoxically, if you would fast a couple of days prior to the surgery, your body makes much more antioxidant defense mechanisms. And by the time the surgeon allows oxygen to enter the area, the tissue is much better protected against radicals. So there is much less damage. So again, very counterintuitively, we think before any major surgery, whenever your health permits it, fasting would protect you from the damage that is inflicted in this way. And it's the same applies to organ transplantation. Clinical trials we are now doing to show whether this is the case. It will also, we think, diminish the side effects of chemotherapy and radiotherapy for all cancer patients that are treated in this way. Because those also damage your DNA. And damage to DNA means aging. So chemotherapy, radiotherapy, it may cure the patient, but you have long and short-term side effects. And we think some of those can be reduced again when you would fast prior to that treatment, whenever that is possible. Also there, we are now doing clinical trials to try and investigations in mice to try and see whether this is really true. And then we also think it may be beneficial for Alzheimer and for Parkinson and for all the dementias. Where proteins aggregate, and we see that also happening in our mice, so we understand also why DNA damage in the end leads to proteins that aggregate, whether it's beta amyloid for Alzheimer or whether it's alpha-synuclein for Parkinson. The phenomenon of protein aggregation we understand from the perspective of aging, and we think that also in that regard, nutritional interventions can prevent the progression of these devastating diseases. So, like with Emma, and this very rare disease, and these mice and these children helped us to understand the basis of aging, and that is very important for our age because we want to promote healthy aging, and we have to first understand what is the main cause of aging. So, 100 years of medical progress, all you can tell me to do is eat less. Absolutely, food is very important for sustaining health. Maybe we will find also medications that also do the same as lower food intake does, without you feeling hungry. But that is something for the future. So there are many people involved, particularly in Rotterdam, the team of Joris Pothoff, and many people, this is even only a partial list, other people in the Princess Maxima in Cologne, and people that have left the laboratory, people with whom we collaborated within the Erasmus, within this ACE, and also people outside. Many funding agencies that have supported our work throughout the years, and I'm very grateful for them. And I'm also particularly grateful for this child that now looks really very happy and is still, and I hope she will stay for long, healthy. Thank you very much. And I hope that this lesson gives you at least some information for staying healthy for long. Thank you.